Picture in the talk of Davide. So the idea is that if you have a material, a piece of material, and you put your material in an electric field, the dipole inside the material will orientate along the field and will create another field that we call polarization. That is the response of the material to the external field. And this polarization, usually what we expand is power series. Here, for the moment, sorry for the notation that is different from Davide. It's called alpha in the Davide talk. I will call chi, because in nonlinear community is chi. It's chi in all the books and all the textbooks. So then you read paper, the notation is different. So for me, it's chi. The polarization can be expanded in terms of the total field E. And everything that is linear optics is here, that you see the first days. You can have material with intrinsic polarization, but it's not the case now in this lecture. And everything that is nonlinear is this term that are beyond the first one. Now, in practice, what it means nonlinear? In a day life, I would like to introduce you what are nonlinear phenomena, because normally in day life you don't see any nonlinear phenomena in optics. And the reason is simple, because to get a nonlinear response for a material, you need a very strong laser source. And for this reason, the first experiment in nonlinear optics, date 1961, it was performed by Franken just 1 year after the discovery of laser. And these are the three guys that developed the field, Blomberg, Shaulow, and Sigvan. And also you can find a very interesting lecture of Blomberg on nonlinear spectroscopy on YouTube. Now, but what it means nonlinear? Well, the simple example to visualize a nonlinear response on material is to change the color of light. Now, imagine you have a laser of a given color, red, yellow, what you want. And you send this laser field, like this one that I have, on a material. The light that is reflected, transmitted from the material, it will be of the same color of the incoming light. So if I send green, you will see green. Less intense, maybe, but you will see green light. There is no way to change color in linear optics. The first phenomena that you can see in nonlinear is exactly instead a phenomenon where you change the color of light. So you send on a material light that is red, you absorb two photons, and then you emit one photon that is a different color, that is green. This is a typical nonlinear phenomena. It's one of the phenomena. There are many others, but this is the simplest one to visualize. Also, it was the first that was measured in the experiment. So where you can find the nonlinear spectroscopy, nonlinear phenomenon in experiment in real life? But the first example is very simple, is exactly this one, the laser pointer. So if you go in a supermarket, you buy your laser, you can buy red, green, then you go home, and imagine you want to open them, and you open the green one. And you discover that the green laser pointer has a laser, that is this one, that has a frequency that is red. This is the wavelength of the red light. But then there is a crystal here that changes the color of the light from red to green. And that's the reason you see green light from the green laser pointer. I have to say that this slide is a bit outdated, because recently Nikai Osbram developed a green laser. And that's the reason also the price of green laser pointer dropped down at the same price of the red. But at the beginning, they were very expensive because they used this technique here. So the first laser pointer were built like this. The new ones are really a green laser direct. But there are also many applications of linear spectroscopy in physics, in research. I will want to show you some examples before discussing how we want to calculate this. This is an example from a resident experiment 2014 on molybdenum disulfide, a 2D material. So you take this 2D material, and you take a picture with your camera, and you see that it's light blue. And you say, oh, it's nice. Light blue, this is molybdenum disulfide. But then imagine you have a camera that can take a picture with the nonlinear response. It means that you send the light with a given frequency, and you measure the response at 2 times the frequency. So you are really probing the nonlinear response of this material. What you will see is something like this, that in reality this was not a single flake, but was composed of many flakes. And if you color the flakes according to the intensity of the light, you can also see the orientation. And this is because nonlinear response is sensitive to the angle between light and the crystal orientation, while linear is not. So this is a typical application or characterization of 2D materials. Another application that was, I want to show you that is nice, is on excitons. So you saw in the on nanotubes. So in the talk of Ludger, for example, the excitons behave like an hydrogen atom. So you have 1s level, 2p, and so on. This is in nanotubes. But for this level, there are some selection rules. So for example, with light, you can excite this first level, but you cannot excite this, the 2p because it's forbidden. But if you go beyond the linear response, so you absorb 2 photons, like in this experiment, you can excite also this level here. And then the system decay and emits light from here. And this is exactly a spectral 2-photon absorption of a nanotube that show for the first time where is the 2p level of the exciton. And then also they can show the 1s from the luminescence. So with this experiment, they want to show that the excitons are present and are here. And instead, if there were no exciton, you have a continuous transition with invalence conduction band, and you will not see this beautiful spot. The experiment was very nice. But also, you have to be honest, they were also very lucky, because the selection rules they applied to explain this experiment, they were wrong. And after some years, people noticed this. It was a Dresselhaus and Dresselhaus. But anyway, they were lucky because this level was invisible in 2-photon absorption, really by coincidence, so not by selection rules. And there are other applications that are this here. Again, when you have the response to the second harmonic generation, so this factor, you send laser with a frequency and you generate photon with 2 times the frequency, this phenomena is different from zero only if you don't have inversion symmetry. If you have inversion symmetry in your material, the response of second harmonic generation will be zero. And this was used, for example, to measure the number of layers. Now, imagine you have deposited some layers of material. If you have only one layer, is the inversion symmetry is broken, so you have a response. If you have 2 layers, there is inversion symmetry, response is zero. 3 layers, you have a response. 4 layers, you don't have a response, and so on. So it's a way to visualize number of layers, or you can visualize the stacking of material, and so on. But you can also probe symmetry, not only of the lattice, but also of electrons. Imagine you have a material that, in principle, has inversion symmetry. But at a certain moment, electrons decide to break this inversion symmetry. For example, for magnetization, when you create a ferromagnet, all the spin go in one direction, so inversion symmetry is not valid anymore. And in this case, really, you can probe magnetic transition with second harmonic generation. This is a typical probe of magnetic transition. So it's zero when you have paramagnetic, and it's different from zero when you broke the inversion symmetry. And then there are some more fancy applications. You can use nonlinear optics in the inverse way. So you send the laser at high frequency, and you generate a lot of photon at lower frequency, like in this case. They send a laser that is green and then create many photons that are red. And this is used to create entangled photons for quantum communication, quantum information. And there are different experiments that use nonlinear crystal in this way. Or there are some applications in biology that are nice. You can take a nanocrystal that has a strong nonlinear response. You attach the nanocrystal to a protein, you put in a living system, and then you can follow the protein. In a simple way, you send a red laser on your living system, and you see where the system responds in green. And because biological material, they don't have a nonlinear response, you see only the response from these crystals. And so you can see the protein then move and so on. The nice point of this technique is that different from green fluorescence protein, there is no quenching, so it's always stable, the nonlinear response. And then there are also the dark side of nonlinear response. There are some applications where you want to avoid nonlinear response. And one example is optical fibers. So you want to transmit your signal from here to another place, and you want to transmit as far as possible. So you have your optical fiber, you want to send a pulse inside the optical fiber as strong as possible in such a way that it arrives far, far away. But there is a phenomenon called self-focusing, so it means the beam will start to focus in the center of the optical fiber, at the end it will burn it. And this is due to a nonlinear response of the optical fiber. And unfortunately, at present, no method is known for increasing the self-frequency limit of optical fiber. This is from photonic encyclopedia. So it's an intrinsic limit of materials, the number of light that they can transport due to the nonlinear response. Okay, this was an introduction to show you some phenomenon nonlinear response. And now, how we calculate nonlinear response in YAMBO? Well, in part, it was already shown by Davide, but the idea is this one. So in this case, we choose an external perturbation. Instead of propagating density matrix, now I will comment on this point, we propagate the Schrödinger equation, clearly not the full Schrödinger equation, it's an effective Schrödinger equation. We propagate in time, we calculate the polarization, and from the Fourier transform of the polarization, we can get linear response, but also nonlinear, all the nonlinear response that you want. So, okay, now everything seems easy, but there are some technicality and some physics that you need to know in order to implement this equation that I want to show you. And the first point is that how you calculate the polarization. Because the polarization is an object that is not it's easy to define for molecules of finite system, but for periodic system, the definition was unknown for many years. I mean, even textbooks was not a definition of the polarization. And let's see why. So the polarization for a finite system is something easy. You integrate the dipole, or the average of the dipole, and divide it by the volume of your molecule or your system. So you get the polarization. But how you define a polarization in a periodic system, in a bulk system? Now, in the literature, people propose different solutions. For example, you can say, OK, I can average the dipole of the sample, divide it by the volume of the sample. I can use the dipole of the cell divided by the volume of the cell, or I can use the dipole matrix element that you can calculate with YAMBO. In reality, all these three solutions are not good. That's the first, because if you average on the sample, the effect of the dipole cancels inside the sample, and you just get a surface contribution of the superpolarization. So this definition is, in principle, good, but you need to simulate an infinite piece of material and just to have the contribution of the surface, while you want a contribution from the bulk. So no way to this. The second idea, to do the average of the dipole and divide it by the volume of the unit cell, is completely arbitrary, because the unit cell is arbitrary. So imagine a material like this. You have a positive charge here and then negative charge here. You can change this as a unit cell and then repeat periodically, and the dipole is zero. But you can also change the one. Is a valid unit cell, and the dipole is defined in this way. So the dipole in the unit cell is an object that is arbitrary. No, it cannot be used. And if you are thinking about periodic system where you can use the Clausius-Massot relation that is for localized charges, you have to make that this doesn't hold for solids, because solids are wave function are delocalized. And finally, the third way, that is the use of dipole matrix element, is very bad because, okay, intra-band SEM are indefinite, they diverge at the band crossing, so one band touch and so on, also on the state that they generate. For sure, you can use them for linear optics, for the linear response, because you just need valence conduction, but beyond the linear response, they cannot use it anymore. So how we calculate polarization? To calculate polarization, we use an approach that is based on Berry phase. Now, I don't know how many of you are familiar with Berry phase, but I will make a short introduction and to see where it comes from. Now, the idea of Berry phase, this is a picture of Berry that also got the Ig Nobel, is not so complicated. So imagine a Hamiltonian that depends from a parameter, xi. A parameter in the Hamiltonian. So you can, for each value of the parameter, you can diagonalize the Hamiltonian and get wave function and eigenvalues, and also the eigenvalues. Okay, that's fine. Then you change the value of your parameter, for example, from xi1 to xi2, And you diagonalize again your Hamiltonian. You get new wave function, new eigenvalues, and so on. And now you can ask the question, how much the phase or the wave function change when I change this parameter from Xi1 to Xi2? So you can define the change of the phase of the wave function, that is this object here, that is similar in geometry when you have two vectors and you want to define the angle between the vectors. It's the scalar product divided by the modulus. And you can ask how much the phase change. In reality, this question is not a correct question because, as you know from quantum mechanics, the phase is arbitrary. So you can have an arbitrary phase here, an arbitrary phase here when you diagonalize Hamiltonian. So the phase change is arbitrary too. It makes no sense. But what discovered Berry was that if you consider the phase change in a closed path, like this one, so the phase change when you do a path in a parameter space, this object is gauge invariant. It means that if you attach a random phase to this wave function here, since it appears as a Brian cat, the random phase cancels, and you got a new object that is gauge invariant, and so it means that it's a possible observable, because in physics, when you have an object that is gauge invariant, usually is an observable. But this is a bit exotic, because it's an observable that is not expressed in terms of a median operator, so it's a bit wild. And why it exists? Well, because the fact that there is a parameter, and you can also do the limiting continuous difference, it means that your Hamiltonian is not isolated. So this object is like the coupling with, as is saying in the paper of Berry, with the rest of the universe. If you have a really isolated Hamiltonian, and you take in account all the degree of freedom, you will not have the Berry phase. But if your Hamiltonian is coupled with something, you can have observable that are not Hermitian operators. Okay, there are some examples in physics, like the Aaron-Bohm effect, the molecular Aaron-Bohm effect, or the effect in transport that you can remap in this phenomenon of an Hamiltonian coupled with an external parameter. But now, how this is connect with the polarization? To see the connection with polarization, we come back to the electron in a periodic system. When you have electron in a periodic system, you have the wave function to obey to the Bohr van Karman boundary condition. So you have a periodic part and a phase that depends from k. And you solve your one part your Schrodinger equation with these orbitals. And using the Bloch theorem, you can show that this corresponds to the solution of this equation for the u, where k acts as a parameter. So u is a periodic function, and k enter, if you put this wave function here, enter as a parameter on the Hamiltonian. So you can ask the question, okay, if k is like a parameter, if I do a loop in the k space, which is the observable that I will get? And it seems incredible, but okay. What you will get if you do a loop in the k-space, the observable that you will get is exactly the polarization. And this was demonstrated in 1993 by King, Smith, and Vanderbilt. The demonstration is also quite easy. They pass through the Barnier function to demonstrate that this is exactly the Fischer polarization. And I put a few times this slide. The beauty of this object is that it's a bulk quantity, so it doesn't depend from the surface. The time derivatives give the current and reproduce the polarizability to all the order. So it's exactly the way how you should calculate the polarization when you know the wave function. Then they also propose a discretized version of this object and extended to the three-dimensional material. So you have different lines and you average on different lines. Now we have a formula for the polarization, how we are going to use it. The idea is that once you have the polarization, you can also try to find the question of motion. Because you define a Lagrangian, from the Lagrangian they find the Hamiltonian, and from the Hamiltonian, I will skip all this step, but this is a reference. At the end you find the Schrodinger equation for solids, where the coupling with the external field is defined by the derivative in K. At the end, what you can show that the equivalent, the dipole in a solid, is nothing else than this derivative. Okay, a depolarization is expressed with the formula that I showed you before. These are all the ingredients that you need. You need the coupling with the external field and the way to calculate the polarization. And now then you can do all the response function you want. I will show you a typical example also taken from some other code now. This is an example of how people do in open system, but in periodic system, more or less we do the same now that you have the formulation. So imagine you have a molecule and you excite with a field that is like this, so quasi monochromatic or monochromatic, how we do. You get the polarization oscillate with the frequency of the laser, but then there are other smaller oscillations, for example, 2 times the frequency, and this is the nonlinear response of the molecule. This is a typical example from TDFT or Octopus or Fiesta. So these are the way where we simulate a system and its nonlinear response. But now, now that I told you how I want to simulate nonlinear response, I also have to speak about which are the advantages, why we want to use this approach. So the first of all, as I told you, because the coupling is correct, I mean, we have the coupling with all the orders of the external field, so you can simulate all the response function. And every time you have a phenomenon that is coherent with the external field beyond the linear response, you need an approach like this. So maybe we can find another solution, but for the moment, you need an approach like this with the Berry phase. And moreover, there are other advantages to do this simulation of nonlinear response in real time. But the advantage that when you have the polarization, okay, the linear response is just one object, but all these nonlinear coefficients, they represent a very complicated phenomena. For example, the second harmonic generation, it means that you can have a laser, 2 times two fields that with the same frequency, or you have two fields with different frequency that they sum, subtract. So the interference, the possible interference phenomena between the external fields are many, are very different. And in the experiment, they do. They played with some frequency generation, different frequency generation. So they put a laser with a frequency, a laser with another frequency, and then they measure the response in the outcoming frequency. And if you have the third order, the experiment starts to be even more complicated. You can have some or two laser difference with another, two laser at the same frequency. So the number of possibilities is really, really large. Here this is a laser that where you absorb 3 photons and so on. And there are experiments even more complicated. There is this four-way mixing where they put 3 lasers and then they measure the response in the fourth or the 2-photon spectroscopy. So the combination that there are in the experiment are really large. And the advantage of a real-time approach is that you get direct depolarization, and so you can try to extract all the different coefficients for the different possibility. Also, you can simulate the laser that you put in the experiment. Another advantage that I like is that you have only one equation of motion, so the question is always the same, and all the correlation effect are in the Hamiltonian. So if you choose an Hamiltonian, you put some correlation effect. If you choose another Hamiltonian, you have different correlation effect. So Hamiltonian determine all effect that you want to put from the correlation point of view. Okay, let me say that for a moment this approach is limited to single particle Hamiltonian, but we are not playing Go beyond this. And the other advantage of to have a simulation in real time is that you can go in a non-perturbative phenomena, like for example high harmonic generation, where you put a laser at a given frequency and you are able to generate response at different, at many, many frequencies, like 14 times, 20 times the frequency that you put at the entrance in your solids. In other code, you can also copy with the atomic motion, like in Octopus. This is an example of Octopus and so on. And now, okay, also, I want to show you an example of a real-time simulation. So I will, that is, that I took from YouTube, but to give you an idea. So this is the absorption. They put a laser with a frequency that is exactly resonant with this absorption. And so you can see as a density oscillate when R is excited by a laser field. Okay, we can do the same in solids, but I don't have a video yet. Clearly, in this case, but also in the case I will discuss after the density continues to oscillate because we have an Hamiltonian at this Hermitian, so there is not damping, not defacing. So at present,
this is a TDFT calculation.
Become clumped ions. Yes, it's nice.
It's nice.
Okay. So now we'll discuss a bit of the Hamiltonian. As I told you, okay, you want to do time-dependent Schrödinger equation, so all the correlation effects are in the Hamiltonian. So let's see which Hamiltonian we can use. In part, it was shown by Davide, also from Fulvio. So the first Hamiltonian you can use, step zero, is start from the Cohn-Sham Hamiltonian, that is this one here, and fix the density. You see, okay, the density is fixed to the ground state density. And in this case, you are just propagating an independent particle Hamiltonian. And if you do your propagation in time and you analyze the result, what you get is independent particle linear and nonlinear optics. But then you can go beyond, for example, including GW correction. What are GW correction in real time? GW correction are nothing else that a shift of the eigenvalues, so it's like if you add this operator to the previous Hamiltonian, and you change the eigenvalues. Again, you can propagate in time, and you can get a linear and nonlinear response. I had to comment on this, that GW correction for linear response is a shift, but when you go beyond the linear response, it's not a rigid shift anymore. So this is an example of this second harmonic generation aluminum arsenide, and this one you include the GW correction. In the other case, it changes even more the shape of the spectrum. Another effect that you can include is time-dependent R3. In this case, you say, okay, I start from my Cohn-Sham Hamiltonian, but I let the density of the R3 term evolve in time. So you evolve the wave function generates a new density, the density generates a new R3 that moves by the wave function, and so on. So these are the so-called local feed effect. And this is an example, again, a nonlinear response. This is a second harmonic generation cadmium telenite, without and with local field effect, and this is the experiment. So they work. Yeah. Yeah. You can go beyond this approach and say, no, okay, let's try to evolve also the exchange correlation potential. And this is exactly the TDFT. So you evolve the wave function change the density, you update both for the potential, and so on. And this is what you get the DFT. Just a comment on this. Remember, the DFT, it works very well for at least standard DFT. Very well for molecules, but it's not so effective for solids. But there are different reasons, but I like the fact that the Runge-Grosse theorem doesn't guarantee that this theory is correct for solids. So in principle, you should go beyond the simple density in this part. In the code of YAML, we implement also other terms beyond the TDFT. For example, terms in which you include, as was also saying in the talk of David, another term that depends from the polarization, so you can have an Hamiltonian that depends from the density and from the polarization. And this is, if you want, the minimal ingredient to get excitons. You can introduce another way, but this is a really, I find, an elegant way without include divergences in the theory and so on. With this approach, you can also include long-range part, that was accent in R3, and get exciton in the real-time propagation. And finally, you can also derive an Hamiltonian from many body, as was shown by Davide. So you can say that your Hamiltonian is the Hamiltonian GW that I showed you before, plus the sex self-energy that is written in this way, where this is the variation of the density matrix. And this, the real-time propagation of this Hamiltonian is exactly equivalent to the Beda-Salpeter, where I took the picture from Andrea. But when you propagate in real time, coupled with the Berry phase polarization and so on, you can also get the effect of exciton in nonlinear response. I'll show you an example. Boron nitride, because we show only example on this material, this school. I mean, no story. So this is hexagonal boron nitride. And this is the linear response, the electron constant at independent particle. This is when you include local field effect that doesn't do so much. This is the second harmonic generation that resonates at the linear frequency and the half of the frequency. Also here, Lagrange field effect doesn't do so much. And this is Hamiltonian, Hamiltonian cone sham plus the term of Hartree. Then you turn on GW. GW shift rigidly the dielectric constant, but change the shape of the second harmonic generation. And then you get here. And then you can turn on other terms in the Hamiltonian, like the screen and the change, and you get Exeon. So you get your beautiful Exeon in linear response. You get, you see Exeon in the nonlinear response that are replicated because in nonlinear response there is resonance at omega and at 2 omega. Finally, I want to do spend a couple of slides on the phasing. As I told you, if you excite the system, this will oscillate forever. So you have to introduce a dephasing term that, as the one was introduced by Davide, this dephasing term is nothing else the term that in the wave function formula is that bring back the wave function to the ground state. So after a while, you excite it, there is a term that says, okay, let's go back to the ground state. In other code, this term is this is done in post-processing, even if this is much more difficult for nonlinear response, at least for my point of view. And the effect is this one. You introduce a dephasing term that was a very long time, so your system oscillates a lot. It means that you get very sharp peak when you do the Fourier transform. You introduce a dephasing term with a short time, shorter and shorter. It means that you Fourier transform, your peak became broader and broader and broader. So this is really the equivalence between the broadening and the dephasing time. Broadening, dephasing time, broadening. That is the same in density matrix and in Schrodinger. Yeah, it's a parameter. But just to show it, it's a parameter that count because for the spectra you will get at the end.
But without any physical insight?
No, it's like in linear optics. You put a parameter. For sure you can derive from self-energy and so on, but otherwise you put like in linear optics a broadening. And finally, it's a comment on how we extract on linear response. As Davide told, we excite with the sinus electric field, so then we suppose that the polarization oscillates at the frequency of the exciting sinus, plus all the possible multiples, so excite omega, 2 omega, 3 omega, and so on. We have the phasing term, so that they kill the oscillation of the auto oscillation of the system. After some while, we analyze the spectrum to extract all the coefficients of the polarization. And this gives us the response of 2 frequency, 3 times the frequency, and so on. This is for the second or third harmonic generation. So we use these ansatz. But for other response function, you have to find a new strategy. Yeah, I will show you another example. And to finish, I will show a couple of applications. This is an example of nonlinear response in molybdenum disulfide. The red line is the independent particle, and the green is when you turn off exciton, and the point is the experiment, so the agreement is not so bad. The interesting point is that exciton doubled the intensity of the nonlinear response on a material like this, so it was very interesting. Let's say that then, for the experimental point of view, to get the absolute intensity is very difficult. The first experiment got order of magnitude different, one from the other, but now they are converging to the same number. Another example that I want to show you is the how to extract, for example, a coefficient like this one. Imagine that you want to extract the third order response at the same frequency of the exciting laser, that is the 2-photon absorption. How you do? A simple strategy that is a Richardson extrapolation. You do different simulation with a field E, with a field E divided by 2, with a field E divided by 4. And then combining the result of these three, you can cancel this term and get exactly the coefficient you want. This is the strategy to extract coefficient at higher order. So perform different simulation at different intensity, then recombine them to with the correct coefficient in such a way to cancel the term that you are not interested in. And the result is again, start on a BN, sorry. This is a bulk, so this is a the bulk are 2 levels, 2 that are dark and 2 that are bright. And the bright can be excited with the linear optics, but the dark are visible only if you absorb 2 photons. And this is the spectra of linear optic absorption, and this is the spectra of 2-photon absorption. And this one is the experiment performed in Montpellier in 2016. I think, well, that's all. I want to acknowledge some people that collaborate in these works, and Davide, François, Kim, Mirta, Sylvain. And also I would like to leave you on some references that you can find interesting. This is the reference for nonlinear optics. This is very nice for response functions. So, and also there is the demonstration of how the beta salpeter reduced to an hydrogen-like equation when you have parabolic bands, the one that Ludger showed. That is very nice. This is for the Berry phase in the electronic structure by Vanderbilt, but there is also free lecture by Resta. And this is the general electrodynamics of solids. Okay.